I don't care what time says. I don't care what the economy says. I don't care what season you're in. I don't care what your family says. I don't care what anybody says. If you have a word from God and you have been obedient and followed what He said to do and you have sown toward that thing that you're believing for, don't let go. All right, we're going to do them together. Are we ready? For whatever is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is he who overcomes the world but he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So Jesus answered and said to them, have faith in God. For assuredly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. The just shall live by faith. The just shall live by faith. The just shall live by faith. The just shall live by his faith. Good job. You did really well. Thank you, Lord. So we're just continuing. We're talking about faith. How's your faith projects? Good? Still going? Like Journey sing, don't stop believing, right? Right? We're still believing. We're standing in faith, right? Believing God. And I have this lesson that, I have this one teaching that I've been trying to get to for a couple of years on the actual steps of faith. But every time that I go to do it, the Lord leads me on a different path with it. So one day I'm going to get to do it, but he kind of led me down. How many of you have experienced maybe what you consider to be maybe a little bit of a lull in your faith project? Anybody? A little bit? A little bit of a lull? A little bit of a lull? That's okay. That's not we did take your picture and it will be on the internet, but don't take that personally. No. You know, sometimes I think when we're believing God for something for a long, long time and we haven't seen the act, we believe that we've received it. We've done the steps of faith to the best of our ability, yet we're still wanting to see the manifestation of what we're believing for. It is 100% required and necessary to ask and find out why. Good. Absolutely. We have the opportunity to go to God on whatever level we're at, and simply say, Father, show me, am I missing something? Now, that's not doubt. Amen? I'm not talking about doubt and unbelief. I'm talking about, Lord, to the best of my ability, I believe that I'm in faith. I'm not confessing anything but what I want to happen in this situation. My words are good, Lord. I feel like my faith is good. I'm feeding my faith and I'm starving my doubt. And so, Lord, I just humbly wanting to know, Lord, am I missing it? Are you missing it? Lord, you never miss it. You know, one of the worst things to do is to start going to God and telling him on all the goodness of why you should be getting what you're believing for. Go to God with your list of all the good things you're doing. That one always works out really well. Lord, don't you know how much that I've sacrificed? Lord, don't you know? Don't do that. As someone from personal experience, don't do that. Amen? You know, we get mercy. We never want justice from God. We don't ever want what we deserve. Amen? We want his mercy in our lives. So we're going to talk a little bit about tonight about what might be one of those things that potentially could be a hindrance to what we're believing for. Let's go to the book of Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 24. And I've read this verse 1,000 times. But isn't it funny, on the 1,001th, you see something different. Proverbs chapter 24, verse 27. I'll read it first out of the King James. It says, "Prepare thy work without, and make it fit for thyself in the field, and afterward build thine house." Then let's read it out of the Amplified. This gives it a little bit more clarity. "Put first things first. Prepare your work outside and get it ready for yourself in the field, and afterward," say afterward, "build your house and establish your home." The New Living Translation said, "Do your planning and prepare your fields before you build your house." Put first things first. When it comes to faith, we have to put first things first. Why is it more important to plant the field first before we build the house? Logic would say, it's cold outside. Logic would say, but the bears are out there, and the wolves and the snakes. I want to sleep inside. The flesh would say, I want to be comfortable. I want to be warm. I like indoor plumbing. Anybody else like indoor plumbing? Big fan of the Pigeon household of indoor plumbing. Amen? Whoever came up with indoor plumbing, God bless you. It's a wonderful, wonderful thing. Wonderful thing. Moving to me always is kind of like a house is more of like a comfort. Would you agree? Amen? I don't know why I wrote this down, but it's really good. I said, if we could only move according to the leading of the Holy Spirit and not according to what we could afford. What if we made all of our decisions about our homes according to what the Holy Spirit told us to do and not according to what we think we could afford? Where would we live? Amen? What's the number one decision we make when before we buy or do anything? How much does it cost? Right? Or a lot of people, it's more like this. What's the payment? Right? What's the payment? Can I afford the payment? Can I make the payment? So why is it important to prepare the fields before we build the house? Number one, the harvest from the fields that we plant could pay for the house. If I plant a field first, I'm going to get my food, but I'm going to grow enough not just for me, I'm going to grow enough so I can sell some. Amen? And when I grow enough that I can sell some, instead of going into debt to buy the house, if I stand in faith and plant, then I can pay for that house debt-free. You see the difference? So that's why it's important. That's why I want to prepare the fields first. The flesh wants convenience, but what we first need are the necessities. When it comes to our faith projects, I think we have to ask ourselves, Lord, am I going for the comfort first, or am I going for the necessity? Why am I believing what I'm believing for? You ever ask yourself that question? I mean, do we ever really think out what we're believing for sometimes? Like when I was in Bible school, we had Dr. Savelle and Kenneth Copeland and Creflo Dollar and Jesse Duplantis, and they would come to Bible school and teach for weeks at a time, and they would fly in on these most beautiful jets that they had believed God for. And so they would teach us faith, and then the Bible school students would say, Lord, I'm going to believe you for an airplane, because I want a jet just like that to do what they're doing. Okay, maybe you should maybe believe for a bicycle first. Because right now you're walking. Amen? Is there anything wrong with believing for an airplane? Absolutely not. But am I preparing my fields for my harvest, or am I trying to build my house first? Amen? I want to make sure that my fields are prepared. And when I talk about prepared, there is a process and there is an order to faith. There are steps of faith. Romans chapter 4 talks about that. The steps of Abraham. There are progressive steps that we take in faith. And just to give you just a real brief overview, What's the first thing we do when we're going to believe God for something? Number one, need to know if it's God's will. Amen? I want to go back and I want to say, Lord, I'm going to believe you for a new car. Well, there's not a scripture in the Bible that says, thou shalt have a new car. But there are scriptures that talks about delighting yourself in the Lord and he'll give you the desires of your heart. There are other scriptures where God blessed people with abundance. If you look at all the Old Testament patriarchs, they didn't have one horse, they had 1,000 horses. They didn't have one camel, they had 1,000,000 camels. They couldn't ride them all at the same time, folks. Right? God was not scared of abundance with his people. He just didn't wanted us to have things. He didn't want things to have us. Amen? That's where idolatry and covetousness comes from. So the first thing I want to do is, Lord, I want to ask you, is this your will for what I'm believing for? Yes, it is his will. How do I know that? Because I find corresponding scriptures to go along with it, right? So then I want to ponder that. I want to think this thing out. I want to pray this thing out, Lord. Is this something, Lord, that does this make sense in my life? You know, am I believing for something? Am I jumping too far ahead, or do I need to just say, Lord, what's the next step of what I need to believe for? Like the people with an airplane, if you don't have a car, okay, believe God for a car, but then go to the plane next. Amen. So what I do is I fill my heart with faith. I release my faith to God. God takes the image of the thing that I'm believing for, and he builds that image out of the faith that I'm believing with a blueprint in my heart. Now, a lot of times he will ask us to sow what we're believing for. Now, there are certain things we don't have to sow for. I never have to sow for healing. I never have to sow for salvation for somebody in my family. I never have to sow for deliverance. Well, why is that? Because he was the seed for me. For all those. Jesus said there's not a seed good enough for those things, so I'll need to be that seed for you. Amen? So we never charge somebody to pray for their healing. Amen? That's ridiculous. Deliverance, it's all been paid for. Amen? It's all you can eat. Welcome to Luby's. Get in line, get your tray. It's all you can eat. Amen? But when it comes to material things and things of this earth, God will ask us to sow towards the thing that we're believing for. And a scriptural, biblical principle is all seed produces after its own kind. If I believe in God for a car, what kind of seed should I be sowing? Help me. Well, let's say, what if I don't have enough for the car? Let's say I'm believing God for a car. I got $500. I have had a $500 car. You don't want one. They don't last long. Amen? Fatima and Ali, we were at lunch the other day, and they showed us this car that they make in Iran. And it costs like, how much? $1,000 or something? $1,000 is a car made in Iran, and he said like 30,000 people a year die in them because they're so poorly made. It's a terrible car. You do not want a $500 car. Well, Lord, I'm believing you for a car, but I only have $500. And the Lord would say, sow it. Now, this is where you want to be wise about the ground that you're sowing into. I find out Steve and Barbara, guess what they're believing for? A new car. So then I say, Lord, I'm just going to take my $500 and I'm going to sow it into them. Now, once I sow it, I release it. Now, God begins to bring the increase. Now, here's what I can't say, okay, Lord, I can't put a time limit on it. I can't say, Lord, I'm going to have this car in 2 months, 3 days, 6 hours, and 26 minutes. It doesn't work like that. But I will tell you this, what Brother Hagin used to say, payday doesn't come every Saturday night, but it always comes. Okay? And if you're willing to last, stand forever, it won't take that long to get what you're believing for. You have to be completely sold out in this process for it to work. Amen? It's not microwavable. There's no way to speed this thing up any faster. No. You get a word from God. God says, sow. You sow the seed. I sow it into Steve. All seed produces after its own kind. So now what am I looking and believing for? I'm looking and believing God for a car. or an opportunity for a car or something along, it's going to come back to you in that way. If I want apples, what kind of seeds do I need to sow? Apple seeds. If I want oranges, what do I sow? It's the same thing. So all seed produces after its own kind. So I want to make sure that now that I've sown, I believe that I receive it. And I think this is sometimes the step that we miss when we're using our faith, is that we have deceived ourselves and not sown towards what we're believing for. Amen? This is a little bit deeper in, but if you don't believe enough in what you're believing for to invest in it, why should God? Amen? If it's not worthy enough for you to sow into, why would God want to get involved in it? Amen? This is kind of a struggle we have when we talk about faith sometimes. For some reason, and because faith gets misinterpreted and misrepresented, faith turns into free. Free stuff. I'm going to have free stuff. Faith means free stuff. I'm going to have a car, never pay for it. I'm going to have a house, never going to have to pay for it. I'm going to have all these things, Lord, never going to have to pay for it. Well, guess what? You have no investment in it. I am big into making sure that I make an investment into anything that I'm believing for. My faith project, I think everybody knows it, Emily going to college for first year. That's like buying another house. It's really, really small, and it's half a room, and it's in Tulsa, Oklahoma, but it's ours. Amen? That's her dorm room in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Well, guess what? First year's over. Guess what? Paid for. Paid for. Amen. I only had to sell Luke. And look, I still have Jack, and it's great. No. Well, but Pastor, you said you were believing for this big sum. I am. But I'm not getting caught up in waiting for some lump sum to show up at my front door. No, I'm doing my step of faith. And if that step of faith is meeting a monthly payment for what I'm believing for, is it any less faith if I make a payment once a month and it's debt-free? Or if I get a lump sum? Or does it have to be something spectacular? Does the clouds open and a staircase come down and, you know, angels and everybody, you know, does it have to be this spectacular, this event? No, it really, really doesn't. Just believe. That's it. Just believe and don't let go. I don't care what time says. I don't care what the economy says. I don't care what season you're in. I don't care what your family says. I don't care what anybody says. If you have a word from God and you have been obedient and follow what He said to do and you have sown toward that thing that you're believing for, don't let go. It came to pass. And it came to pass. The greatest words in the Bible. And it came to pass. That needs to be your hashtag on everything that you do. Lord, I'm believing. Well, it's never going to happen. No. And it came to pass. Thus saith the Lord, I prophesy this over you. And it came to pass. But just don't let go. Amen? So, how do we prepare the fields for our faith project? I'm so glad you asked. Let's go to the book of Genesis. Let's go to the book of Genesis, chapter 1. Verses 28 and 29. What is the first thing that God gave man in the garden? Go ahead and read it. Read 28 and 29. Genesis chapter 1. What's the first thing that God gave Adam and Eve? What's dominion? What's the first thing He gave them? Dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. The first thing that God gave man was dominion. What's the second thing that God gave man? Next verse. And God said, behold, I have given you every herb bearing seed. The second thing that God gave man was seed. The key to your faith project is your seed. It is the most powerful thing that you have in your possession. to receive the thing that you're believing for. And when I talk about sowing seed, I don't know any farmer that casually ever just threw seed out not caring what was going to happen. I don't know of any farmer. Anybody, any farm folks here? Anybody raised on a farm? You worked cotton field, didn't you work in rice farms and stuff? You raised on a farm? Oh, well, let's not talk about that at church. Mom. Does anybody ever work on a farm? Anybody ever sow some seed? Sowing seed is the most purposeful thing a farmer can do. That's the key to his whole life, is his seed. I don't know any farmer that just said, when they say, what kind of seed do you want? Oh, any old seed will do. I don't care, whatever you got. Let me, this is a little off, but it's this, whenever you're giving in the offerings, you need to be purposeful about what you are giving towards. Every dollar you put in that collection plate should have a purpose, because it is a seed that you are planting. And if you're just throwing it in the plate saying, Lord, I really don't care, guess what you're going to get back? Well, guess what? I really don't care either, says the Lord. You don't care, I don't care. Amen? Sowing seed is one of the most powerful things that a believer can do, especially when it comes to our faith project. While the earth remains, let's go 8:22. While the earth remains, seed time and harvest, and cold and heat, and summer and winter, and day and night shall not cease. This is the way that God gave us to produce and for prosperity in the earth today. Why? Because it's always going to be here, and it's always been here. What is it? Seed, time, and harvest. That's faith. Brother Oral Roberts, probably one of the pioneers of seed faith. And I encourage you to get any book that he's written on the subject, and it's probably some of the, for our generation, some of the best preaching and teaching on seed faith. Seed, time, and harvest is always going to be here. It is the way that God's kingdom works. Genesis 18, O Lord, please let this be what I think it is and not something. I'll prove it to you. I'm not going to say. I'm going to get to it first, and then I'll tell you what, if I'm right or not. Yeah. Genesis 18:10. This is the story of Abram and Sarah. What were Abram and Sarah believing God for? They had a child, right? Was this child ever... how did they know they were going to have this child? They had a word from God, didn't they, Rose? They had a word from God. So my question is, Abram and Sarah are believing God for a child, and God himself came down and said that you're going to have this child, why didn't the child just instantly appear? God said. Now, they had to use more than use their faith. They had to sow some seed. Come on. There was a seed that had to be sown towards that child. I'm sorry, are there children in here tonight? I'm sorry, I'm getting some of the blankest looks. What is he talking about, Myron? I don't know. Abram had to sow for what they were believing for. Now look, everything that they were believing for in the natural looked impossible. She was 80, he was 90. Okay, game over right there. Right? So everything that they were believing for, it looked impossible. Their age was against them. Now, I have to remember that Sarah also, she had been barren during her childbearing years. She had never had a child. So even when everything was perfect and she was the right age and all the stars had lined up, she still had not been able to produce a child. So then possibly there's also a medical reason of why they can't have a child. And thirdly, Abram, I mean, when you're that age and that old, there were several things that had to fit back into order in order for this to take place. In the natural, it looked impossible. It really, really did. To the point where when the angel prophesied it to you, what'd Sarah do? She laughed. She said, there's just no way that this was going to happen. Age was against them. Barrenness was against them. Medical reasons were against them. But I love Genesis 18:14. Is anything too hard or too wonderful for the Lord? Put that up there for me. Is anything too hard for the Lord? At the time appointed, I will return unto thee, and according to the time of life, and Sarah shall have a son. You need to make that part of your confession every day. Is anything too hard for the Lord? The Lord thrives in impossible situations. Faith works the best in impossible situations. That's what it was built for. Faith has the ability to change the circumstances of any situation. It is one of the most powerful forces on the face of the earth, and when it's applied by a believer in faith, you can change history. That's how powerful that our faith is. Is anything too hard from God? Do you have a word from God, and have you sown? Does anybody have a word from God on your faith project? Yeah? Have you sown towards it? Amen. It's vital. Sometimes that is the missing thing. If I'm believing God, okay, well, Pastor Jack, what if I don't have any seed? Then guess what you should be believing for? Seed. See how simple that is? We should be believing for seed. Lord, I need to believe you for a new car. Well, what do you have right now? I got about $20. Well, then, Lord, I'm going to sow this $20, and I'm going to sow it for more seed. Now, can a $20 bill produce a car? I guess. But you want to have a seed that you want to bring something honorable. Amen? Well, it depends on what kind of car you want to drive. You want that $500 car? Sow that $20 bill and see what happens. Amen? And so what I want to do is I want to sow that seed, and I'm going to say, Lord, I'm sowing it for more seed. Lord, I need a bigger seed. I want to produce a seed. But see, this is all part of the process, because this is you and God spending quality time together discussing this project together. God is your partner in this endeavor. And he's not your secret partner. He's the general partner. It is you and him sitting down at the table in his word and you discussing how this project's going to come out. And you're bringing your plan, and he's saying, oh, let's make a little adjustment here. And he's leading you, and he is guiding you. And I know I've said this a million times, but I'm going to say it again. It's not about what you're believing for. That thing's going to be gone one day. It is what you learned on the way. That is the most precious thing that you'll ever have. Because those moments when you heard God, I got to say this too. A lot of times, folks, we just need to learn how to hear God's voice. I got to tell you, as a pastor, that's the number one thing that I hear from people. I don't hear God's voice. He never speaks to me. He doesn't talk to me. I never hear God's voice. Well, I'd have to say then, have we lowered all the other voices so that you can hear his voice? Because it's a still, small voice. And I would have to say, how much time are you spending in your word? Because that's primarily how he's going to speak to you. He spoke to me through Proverbs 2 or 3 days ago about this verse. I'd read it 1,000 times, but all of a sudden it was like, prepare your fields first, then build your house. There's a sowing and reaping principle here. There's a faith principle here that I'd never seen before. And I wasn't even looking in the Bible for faith, but yet there it was. This is all about you and God sitting down at whatever that secret place is where you talk and you opening up your heart and him teaching you, leading you, and guiding you. It says in Corinthians, eye has not seen nor ear heard, nor entered into the heart of man those things that God has prepared for those that love him. But he reveals them to us by his Spirit. So, how many of us are born again? All of us are born again, right? So where's that Spirit? Where's his Spirit? It's in you. He's not next door, right? He's with you. He's already in there. So all I have to do, now here's a funny little side note, but this will happen. His voice will sound like your voice sometimes because he's coming through your Spirit. Lord, was that you or was that me? Or was it profound and it changed your life? Then that was him. If it was about food or comfort, then that was about you. Right? Now, we've had those times. We all want those times, that Mount of Transfiguration where God himself stands and we hear and we celebrate. And those are wonderful, great times. But I value the times where I got really, really quiet and I heard him. And I knew I heard him. And I was like, he's in this. See, to me, that's more precious than any other thing that you could ever. More, you know, believing God for homes, cars, any of those types of things, those are wonderful things. But to have just a few seconds in his presence, under that anointing, hearing him, Father to Son, Spirit to Spirit, those things can never be taken from you, ever. That's what this is all about. God longs to spend time with his child. And this is the way that he does it, through faith. Abraham figured out that the only way to receive from God was by faith. Therefore, guess what? Abraham became very, very pronounced in faith. When he found out that this is the way to please God and it was accounted to him for righteousness, and he was called a friend of God, was Abraham a perfect guy? Made a few mistakes along the way. One or two, right? The whole Ishmael thing. We don't need any Ishmaels in our life, do we? No, we don't need to help God with his promises. He's got it covered. All we have to do is do the part that he asks us to do. Amen? So, look at Galatians chapter 6, verse 7. Galatians 6, verse 7. Be not deceived. Why would he say that to start that verse? Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For a few things that a man soweth, whatever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Why would he have to start it off with be not deceived? Obviously, there's an opportunity for us in this to be deceived. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he reap. And I think sometimes we believe that we're believing God, that we're standing in faith for something, but we've deceived ourselves because we haven't sown anything. We've gone through the motions. Everybody thinks that we're in faith. They believe that that's what we're doing. But in reality, we've kind of deceived God. But the more dangerous part is we've deceived ourselves. Because once again, if we don't think that whatever I'm believing for is important enough for me to invest in, why should God? Be not deceived. If this is really something that you're invested in, if this is really something that you believe you have a word from God in, then you need to be the first person to invest in it with your seed. You need to sow it in. You need to be the first person to sow this seed. The very first one off the bat. And then we need to be all open to, Lord, is there other seed that you'd have me to sow? But we want to ask him, Lord, I do not want to fool myself or you. In Genesis 26, 12, don't you love the Word of God? Love the Word of God. Genesis 26, 12. Genesis 26, 12. Is it up there? I want to read it out of the Amplified. It said, then Isaac sowed seed in that land and received in the same year 100 times as much as he planted, and the Lord favored him with blessings. And the man became great and gained more and more until he became wealthy and distinguished. He owned flocks, herds, and a great supply of servants, and the Philistines envied him. Go back to verse 12. Then Isaac sowed seed in that land and received that times a 100-fold return. Amen? So obviously what happened was, is God told Isaac, he gave him the most ideal conditions to sow. He must have given him the greatest weather, the greatest land, the most water, the most ideal soil, a once-in-a-lifetime cycle with the moon and the sun, so that this was the ultimate. I mean, how else are you going to get 100-fold, right? This must have been the 100%. I mean, God must have written in the sky, Isaac, sow now. Sow now, quick. This is the best time. Let's back up a few pages and find out what kind of season that it was in. Go back to, look at 26:1. Genesis 26:1. What? And there was a what in the land? Now, how do you get a 100-fold return on seed that you'd sown in a time of famine? See, when God has you sow, it's not always going to look ideal. Let me just be real honest with you. You're never going to have it when He asks you to sow it. You know, I don't know if this is 100% true. I've heard it preached before. But when God told Noah to build the ark, He had to have the seeds to grow the trees, to produce the lumber, to build the ark. Amen? You ever heard that before? I don't know if I could, I don't know if I can prove that out biblically. But man, you talk about a process of what the guy had to do. I mean, you don't even have the tree. Here, build this ark. What's an ark? We're going to build out of these trees. Well, where are those trees? Here's the seed. Here's the seed. Grow the trees, feed the trees, water the trees, cut down the trees, strip the trees, cut the trees up, build the ark, save the earth. Not very convenient, is it? What are you doing this weekend, Noah? I'm working on the boat again. What are you guys doing? Been working on this boat for 465 years. One day there's a rain coming. What's rain? I don't know. I'm just building the boat. I'm just building the boat. This is where, listen to me, and I'll wrap it up with this. Faith is of the Spirit. It's a spiritual thing. It has nothing to do with your five physical senses. Your mind is going to tell you, just like Noah's mind told him, and Moses' mind told him, and David's mind told him, and all these, Jesus' mind told him, and all these other people, their mind said, this is not going to work. This is impossible. And God said, if you will trust me, when you sow, when I tell you to sow, I don't care what the conditions are. If you're obedient to me, I will give you a 100-fold return on what you're sowing. You are not limited to these earthly circumstances. God gave you your faith so that we would have dominion over our circumstances and over our areas. Amen? So, with this, whatever you're believing for, make sure that you've prepared your fields first. Make sure that you've prepared your fields first. Make sure that you've done all the outside work for what you're believing for. Then build the house. Amen? Let's stand up. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for tonight. We thank you for the word. We plead the blood of Jesus over us, Lord. I thank you for each person's faith project. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that you're not a people, Lord, that you're hiding from, that you're of mysteries and riddles, Lord. You're not a God that's trying to puzzle us or confuse us. No, Lord, you want a straight, direct shot into our hearts. Lord, I declare that each one of us, we know the voice of the Good Shepherd, and the voice of another we will not follow. Our ears are open, Lord. Our spiritual ears are open. Say this, my spiritual ears are open. I know His voice, and He knows mine. In Jesus' name. Amen. Love y'all. We'll see you Sunday.